Alors, everyone, I hope you are well and you are keeping safe. Because of this COVID-19, things will not be the same. But I hope you are remembering to study, because whatever we've done will not go back. And so we must pay particular attention to everything that we've done. So we continue with machine design. And this time around, we are going to look at the gears. So what we need to understand about gears is that transmission of rotary motion between rotating shafts is one of the main common applications that are dealt with in machine analysis. And in doing this, gears are the most common machine elements that are used to transmit rotary motion, and they perform the task with uniform motion. So here are the learning outcomes for this topic. Number one, we are going to understand, identify and discover different types of gears. We are going to understand gear failure mode and prevention and dissolving the assignment. So we will not tackle this one because it was tackled in the assignment. We are going to also explore and understand the best gear tooth nomenclature and gear arrangements. Then we are going to drive gear parameters, and then from there we are going to build knowledge on modern gear system design and analysis. Okay. So here the introduction. Gears are tooth wheels used to transmit power. And so generally gears are used for power transmission. However, they can accomplish much more. So when you look at the gears, we are just looking at power transmission. Now, power transmission is a movement of energy from each place of generation to a location where it is applied to perform useful work. And so, to do this useful work of power transmission, gears are made to high precision. You can't afford to make a mistake when it comes to power transmission. So, we can now look at the classification or types of gears. We have spur gears, we have helical gears, we have bevel gears, we have worms and worm gears. So spur gears, the most common and have a very simplest geometry. And when you look at spur gears, they have teeth that are parallel to the axis of rotation and they connect parallel shafts. Although useful, these spur gears have some limitation, and they are limitation that they tend to be noisy due to abrupt contact of the gear teeth. And we can look at helical gears. These have teeth inclined to the axis of rotation, and these helical gears are not noisy because of a more gradual engagement of the teeth during meshing. Then we have the bevel gears, whose teeth formed on conical surfaces, and they are most used for transmitting motion between intersecting shafts. So in dealing with intersecting shafts, bevel gears are the thing that you can use. Then you have the worms and worm gears. The worm assembly is like a screw. The direction of rotation of the worm gear, also called the worm wheel, depends upon the direction of rotation of the worm and upon whether the worm teeth are cut right hand or left hand. So we are going to look at these in details, helical gears, bevel gears, and worm gears as we go along in this lecture. So here is the nomenclature of what we are going to talk about, the nomenclature for gears. So we have the addendum, the dendendum, we have the face width, the top rand. On top there, we have an addendum circle, we have a pitch circle, we have this width of space that remains between these two teeth, we have a flank, the face, the clearance circle, the addendum circle, the ferret radius, and the clearance. And so we're going to look at one of each and see how we will be able to at least do understand these things and appreciate the nomenclature of gears. So we're going to begin with the pitch circle. This is simply the theoretical circle upon which all calculations are usually based. Its diameter is a pitch diameter. Then you have a pinion, which is the smaller of the two mating gears. The raja is often called the gear. Then you have a circular pitch, which is the distance measured on the pitch circle from a point on one tooth to a corresponding point on an adjacent tooth. Then you also have the module M, which is the ratio of the pitch diameter to the number of teeth. So when you look on your right hand side here, we have a formula for the module, we have a formula for the circular pitch, and we have a formula for the diametral pitch. And if the diametral pitch is the ratio of the number of teeth on the gear to the pitch diameter. Then you also have the addendum, which is the radial distance between the top end and the pitch circle, and it's denoted by the letter A. And the dendendum is denoted by the letter B, which is the radial distance from the bottom land to the pitch circle. And so this is what we are going to use most on gears. And after that, you also have a clearance circle and a clearance, and also the backlash. And when you look at the backlash, it's the amount by which the width of a tooth space exceeds the thickness of the engaging tooth measured on the pitch circles. So these are the gear nomenclature, and we'll be using these terms as we go along. Okay, so we can now look at the conjugate action. The conjugate gear tooth action, this is when two rotating bodies in contact, they must have a constant speed ratio, and so the contact half must be connected or related to each other. As you can see on this figure on the right hand side, we have tooth profiles that are designed so as to produce a constant angular velocity ratio during meshing. So when one curved surface pushes against the other, the point of contact occurs where the two surfaces are tangent to each other. So we said when these contact surfaces must be connected or related to each other, so the tangent, which happens at point C there, and then there is a common normal line AB passing through C and P, and all of these forces are at any instant are directed along that common line, and so to transmit motion at a constant angular velocity ratio, the pitch point must remain fixed. So that's what you need to understand about this conjugate action of gears. So forces are transmitted on line of action, which is normal to the contacting surface, and the angular velocity ratio is inverse proportion to the radii or to point P. And so equation 13.5 gives you the angular velocity ratio, which is inverse proportion to the radii to point P at the pitch point. Then circles drawn through P at that point from each fixed pivot are pitch circles, and those pitch circles, each one will have its own pitch radius. So if you were to give the youth, then the gear turret changes in center to center distance, and so there will be no variation in angular velocity ratio. So we're going to see how we can calculate the center to center distance, how we can also calculate the angular velocity ratio, and so on and so forth. So we look now at involute properties. So an involute curve may be generated with a partial flange B. When you look on the right hand side, those figures are tied to the cylinder A around which lapped a cord held tight. So point B on the cord represents a tracing point, and as the cord is lapped and unlapped from about the cylinder, point B will trace out the involute curve AC. So that's how you do about this involute curve. When the generating line DE is normal to the involute at all points of intersection, and at the same time is always tangent to the cylinder. So that is about the involute properties, and now we can look at the fundamentals or tooth action. So when you look at this figure on the right hand side, when two gears are in mesh, their pitch circles flow on one another without slipping. And so the pitch line velocity will be given by this equation. And thus, we already know that there is a relationship between the radii and the angular velocity, which we had looked up in the previous slides, and it's given by that relationship. So the addendum on data time distance for standard interchangeable tips are 1 over P or 1.25 respectively. So those must be remembered. Then we look at, we continue with stuff action. If we construct stuff profile through point A, then you look at this diagram on the right hand side and draw a radial line through the intersection of this profile with which circles to the gear center, we obtain the angle of approach for each gear. And so that's how we obtain the angle of approach. But not only that, we also have what we call the angle of recess. So the final point of contact will be where the addendum circle of a driver crosses the pressure line. So the angle of recess for each gear is obtained in a manner similar to that of finding the angle of approach. So you may imagine a rack as a spur gear having an infinite right pitch diameter. And so if that be the case, then the rack has an infinite number of tips and the base circle, which is an infinite distance from the pitch point. And so when you increase the center distance, you are going to increase the pressure angle and decrease the length of the line of action. But the teeth are still conjugate and the requirement for uniform motion transmission is still satisfied. And so the angular velocity ratio will not change. Okay, and look at contact ratio. The arc of action is the sum of the arc of approach and the arc of recess. So you get the sum of the arc of recess and the arc of approach. When you add them together, you're going to get the arc of action denoted as QT. So the contact ratio now becomes the ratio of the arc of action and the circular pitch, and it's noted as MC to differentiate it from the module. So MC becomes the arc of action divided by the circular pitch. And the contact ratio is the average number of pairs of teeth in contact. Okay. So because of the nature of this tooth action, either one or two pairs of teeth in contact, it is convenient to define the term contact ratio as that equation which is given there, which when you look at the diagram below there, you'll be able to deduce that equation. So gear should not generally be designed having contact ratio less than about 1.2, because the inaccuracies in mounting might reduce the contact ratio even more. So that's how, even when you come to design, this becomes a very important parameter, that your contact ratio should not be less than 1.2 because of that reason given there. And so increasing the width of weapon between the teeth as well as increasing the noise level, that will be the result. We can now look at interference. So interference is a condition when tooth profiles overlap each other. When you look at the diagram on your right hand side, so they overlap each other, and the contact occurs between non-conjugate surfaces. So interference generally occurs due to using gear with too few teeth, but it can also occur when the center distance is shortened. So the conjugate surfaces exist only above the base circle, and so if the contact below the base circle need to be avoided. So what you need to do is that interference is most likely to occur for gears with no pressure angle and low tooth number. So when gear teeth are produced by the generation process, interference is automatically eliminated because the cutting tool removes the interfering portion of the flank, and this effect is called undercutting. Okay, so here is how you analyze interference analysis. The smallest number of teeth on a spur pinion and gear 1-to-1 gear ratio, which can exist without interference, is NP, and the number of teeth per gear is given by this formula A, where K is equal to 1 for full depth equals 0 for ratio teeth of where you have the pressure angle given there. And if the mating gear has more teeth than the pinion, then MG becomes NG over NP, which is equal to M. This is more than 1. And so NP will be given by that, which is the number of teeth on the pinion. And if the largest gear with a specified pinion is interference free, then the equation becomes that one. And the small spinion who had to operate with a life without interference, you see, given by the last equation on this slide. Okay. So I continue with the interference analysis. For a pressure angle of 20 degrees, the most useful values from the second and third equation that we've looked up in the previous slide will be calculated as shown in this table. So if you press minimum NP, your maximum NG, and your NGEA, and your gear ratio there. So this table simply gives you a values for a 20 degree pressure angle. Okay. So when you increase the pressure angle to 25, allows a smaller number of teeth, as you can see in this table. And so to fix interference issues, you have to shorten the path of contact by decreasing the addendum. You also have to increase the pitch radius while holding the diameter pitch constant. Increasing the pitch radius will cause an increase in the number of teeth. Then the other thing you can do to fix the interference issue is to increase the pressure angle. And so when the base when you increase the pressure angle, the base circle becomes smaller. And so not that the advantage of a large pressure angle is an increase in radio force for the same amount of the transmitted force. So these three are issues that you can do to fix interference issues. So one, you shorten the path of contact. Two, you increase the pitch radius. Three, you increase the pressure angle. Okay, the forming of gear teeth. And when you look at the gears, there are a large number of ways of forming the teeth of gears. One of them would be sand casting, shell molding, investment casting, permanent mold casting, die casting, centrifugal casting, etc., etc. So the teeth may be finished after cutting by either shaving or burnishing. Several shaving machines are available. That cutoff minute amount of metal being the accuracy of the tooth profile within the limit of 0.01 millimeters or 250 micro inches, as you can see by those three figures shown in the slide. Okay, now we can now look at bevel gears, and from there we look at helical gears, and then we look at worm gears in detail. So bevel gears are an efficient means of transmitting power in intersecting shaft arrangements. They connect shafts typically intersecting at 90 degrees angle, though other angles are very much possible. And so we have about three types of bevel gears in existence. We have a straight bevel gear, which we are going to concentrate on. We have also the spiral bevel gear and the eye-point bevel gear. So straight bevel gear is the simplest, and the bevel gears can be used for speed reduction, but sometimes they are also used to simply transmit power between intersecting shafts. And when you look at this, there is a fairly common ratio, which is 1:1. So to transmit motion between intersecting shafts, you use bevel gears. And so when you look at this diagram or figure on the right hand side of the slide, you will see that the angle, the two angles can be calculated using this formula, an equation 13.14, and the shape of the teeth projected on back cone is same as in a spur gear with radius R and B, and the ratio number of teeth in this special spare gear is given by equation 13.15. Now you can look at the parallel helical gears. So helical gears are similar to spur gears in overall function. However, unlike spur gears, the teeth on helical gears are cut at an angle, and this angle we call it the Erick's angle to the gear's axis of rotation. So helical gears are extremely versatile and can be used in parallel or intersection shaft arrangements. So when you look at this, You add the axial force component to shaft and bearing, and there will be smoother transition of force between the mating teeth due to gradual engagement and disengagement. So there will be no that noise that occurred in spur gears. And so the tooth shape is involuntary coiled, and so the angled teeth gear teeth are longer in helical gear than straight gear teeth for the same face with teeth. And because of the longer teeth, helical gears can carry higher loads than spur gears of the same size. Okay, so you look at the figures on your right hand side of the slide. We can actually look at the transverse circular pitch in the plan of rotation, also of the normal circular pitch, and we can have the relationship between this given by equation 13.16 and the relationship between the axial pitch along the direction of the shaft axis will be given by equation 13.17 and the normal diameter pitch by equation 13.18. And the relationship between the angles will be given by equation 13.19. Okay, so viewing along the teeth, the apparent pitch loss is greater than when viewed along the shaft. And so the greater virtual error, the greater virtual number of teeth, and it will be given by equation 13.20. And so you have to allow fewer teeth on helical gears without undercutting. You can also look at interference with helical gears. The pressure angle in the tangential rotation direction will be given by that equation. And the smallest tooth number of helical spur pinion that will run without interference is given by that equation. And the largest gear with the spur pinion is given by that. And the last equation gives you the smallest pinion that can be run with a lock. So those are the equations that you can use when it comes to interference with helical gears. Now we can look at worm gears. So worm gears are another common gearing for right angle shaft arrangement. So worm gears allow for very high reduction ratios compared to other gearing systems. And so this worm gear set consists of a worm meshing with a worm gear, and the worm is essentially a threaded screw, and the worm gear can be thought of as a special helical gear. So we are going to specify the lead angle for worm and the helix angle for the gear because of that arrangement. So when you look on the figure on your right hand side, you can see, you can specify also the axial pitch for worm and transverse circular pitch for the gear, and the pitch diameter for this will be measured using equation 13.25. Okay, so the worm can easily turn the worm gear, but the gear may not easily turn the worm, and so when the worm gear set is caught self-locking on the worm gear, cannot drive the worm. When the worm gear can drive the worm, then this is called overholding. So those are the two terms, self-locking and overholding. It may be required to explain some of those terms, so we need to understand this. So worms may have any pitch diameter and should be same as used for the gear teeth. And the recommended range for worm pitch diameter as a function of center distance is given by equation 13.26. And the relationship between the lead and the lead angle will be given by equation 13.27 and equation 13.28. Okay, so we can now look at the tooth system. So a tooth is a standard that specifies the relationship involving the addendum, the dendendum, the working depth, the tooth thickness, and the pressure angle. And so tooth forms for worm gearing have not been highly standardized because there has been less need of width. So the first width of the worm gear should be made equal to the length of a tangent to the worm pitch circle between its points of intersection with the addendum circle. So when you look on the tables on the right hand side, it gives you at least the tooth system. Okay, And so the standard drift properties are given in this table, so you should take time to go through that table. And so here are also the two properties. We have the working depth, the clearance, the addendum of gear, the gear ratio, and this becomes very important that you go through them. Okay, so now we can look at the gear trains. So a gear train is simply a combination or series of several pairs of gears. As you can see on that figure up there, so it's a combination of several pairs of gears which form the gear train. And when you look at gear train, two classifications exist. Number one, we have the ordinary gear train, and number two, we have the planetary gear train. And when you look at the ordinary gear train, it's further subdivided into two. We have a simple ordinary gear train, and we have a compound gear train. So these gear trains allow for a positive drive mechanism to generate a constant pressure modification of speed. And so the process of designing gear train is an iteration process. So we need to go through every time to find the best way that we're going to transmit that constant pressure modification of speed. So we are going to do a lot of iterations. So if you consider this figure we have here, and you consider pinion 2 driving gear 3, the speed of a driven gear then becomes given by that equation where in the direction or levels per minute, N is the number of teeth, and D is the pitch diameter. Then gear 3 becomes an hydra that affects on the direction of rotation of gear 6. And gear 2, 3, and 5 are driver, or gear 3, 4, and 6 are driven members. We define the gear train E as the product of driving tooth numbers or the product of driven tooth numbers. Okay. So as a rough guideline, a gear train value of up to 10 to 1 can be obtained with one pair of gears. A two-stage compound gear train can obtain a train value of 100 to 1. So to obtain more compound two gear and two the same shaft, as you can see in the figures below. Okay, now we can look at the planetary gear train. So a planetary gear train sometimes called the epicyclic gear train, which allows the axis of some of the gears to move relative to the other axis. So you're going to have this figure we have, figure 13.3. We have a sun gear, which has a fixed center axis. Then we also have the planet gear, which has a moving center axis. And so the planet carries, or the arm carries the planet axis relative to the sun axis, and it allows for 2 degrees of freedom. And so we have a sun gear, we have a planet gear, and then we have a ring gear to make a complete planetary or epicyclic gear train. So the planetary gear train, the train value is relative to the arm and will be given by equation 13.32, where your NF is the revolution per minute for the gear in planetary train. For the first gear, then 1, NL for the last gear, and we have NA for the arm. Okay, now we can look at the force analysis of spur gearing. So when you look at the at this figure we have, figure 13.32, figure A, we have the pinion and the gear, and so you will know that when the pinion is moving counterclockwise or clockwise, the gear moves counterclockwise. And as that happens, then you will be able to see the forces that will exist on these two, the pinion and the gear, and they will be indicated by the figure B. And so now you'll be able to calculate the speed at which this moves and the forces that act on them. So, so from there, we also have what we call the transmitted load, which is a tangential load, which will be given by that equation. And so when you separate those gears, this becomes the forces that will act on that gear. And it is the Joseph component of force transmitting the torque, and the torque will be given by that formula. Okay, and the transmitted power H will be given by this formula in equation 13.33, and the pitch line velocity, which is the linear velocity to the point of the gear at the radius of the pitch circle, and it will be given by equation 13.34. Okay, and so use of power relation in customary units will be given by equation 13.35, but in SI units, the use of power will be given by equation 13.36. And so since we are using SI units, so the use of power relationship will be utilizing 13.36 in this course. When you go to bevel gear, in turning shaft and bearing rod for bevel gear application, the usual practice is to use the tangential or transmitted rod that would occur if all the forces are concentrated at the midpoint of the tooth. So what you do for bevel gear, when you look at the figure on the right hand side, your transmitted rod becomes equal to that equation, and the forces acting at the center of both the tooth are shown as that equation there, which can be deducted or deduced from the figure in your right hand side. And we go to helical gearing. It has a three-dimensional view of forces acting against the helical gear tooth, which are shown in the figure on your right hand side. And so the three components of the total, which is a normal tooth force, are, we have these three. We have a total force, we have a radial component of the force, and we have a tangential component of the force. And also we have the actual component of the force. So we have a radial component, tangential component, and actual component. And we add, so we are going to have a total force multiplied by sine phi to give you the larger component when you're dealing with force analysis on helical bearing. And all these are shown on the figure on your right hand side. When it comes to worm gearing, if friction is neglected, then the only force exerted by the gear will be a force W, as shown when you look on these figures on your right hand side, and the equation that will be used. These equations, since the gear forces are opposite to the worm forces, you are going to utilize this equation below there, and when you introduce a coefficient of friction, the equation changes to these last equations you can see on the slide. And so that the case, and the efficiency can be defined by using this equation. And so when you do some rearranging, your efficiency for worm gearing will be given by that equation. And the figure, the graph on your right hand side, shows main experiments that have been conducted to find the coefficient of friction. And it was found that the coefficient of friction is dependent on the relative or sliding velocity. And the formula for sliding velocity is that last equation on this slide. Okay, so we will end there, and this is what you need to know about gearing. So the next time that we're going to have another thing, I think we're going to go through tutorials to see how we can answer questions when it comes, especially in the force analysis on the helical gears and worm gears, because on spar and bevel, it seems much simpler. So we're going to look at that. And so stay safe. And always remember to study. Okay, see you.